You guys hear me all right? Back there? Good to go? Sweet. All right, so as you heard, my name is Danny Murphy. I graduated here in 2014 with a BFA in graphic design. And I'm going to kind of walk you through what I started out as and what I was doing here and how that helped and transitioned then into the work that I'm doing currently and the steps in between, basically, which is a lot of freelance for a short period of time, and then freelancing at Leo Burnett, actually, and then moving into full-time. So first off, I just want to say a huge thank you to the teachers, staff, and everybody in between, because without you guys, we really wouldn't have the fundamentals and just those little pieces that you realize you need every day. Got it? Good to go?
Just kind of rub it on you.
All right. No rubbing, so we're back in it. So they really just encourage you to take that leap into the creative field and really stick with it, because I know outside of here, when you're talking to like maybe your uncle or aunts, they kind of discourage you. They're like, oh, that sounds like a huge risk going into the creative field. You really can't make money there, and it's going to be difficult. But if you play your cards right and you just stay focused on what you want to do, it's not any tougher than any other job. So the plan today is to share a little bit about my story, both here at the Academy and up to this point as an art director, and the steps in between that I found helpful to get the jobs that you want right off the bat. So who here is a designer? Cool, we got a few people out there. All right, so the things we won't be covering today are printer troubles. We all know about those. No reason to bring it up. And Adobe programs crashing. That always happens at the most inconvenient times, you know, 20 minutes before a critique or when you have a big presentation. And the Apple beach ball of death. And yep, it's that one. Which is usually followed by being nervous, being kind of discouraged, and sometimes tears. So we're going to stay off of that for this presentation. So jumping back to the time here at the Academy, the work that I started to make here really set the pace for the opportunities that came up leaving here. And the best advice I can give is to really take the work that you do here almost as if it's a job. Because if you treat it the same way that you would in the workplace, it'll be much easier to just continue that momentum and just continue staying focused on doing things. If you treat it as though, like, once you leave the classroom, I'm just going to go home, not think about what I'm doing at school from day to day, it makes it much tougher once you hit the real world, because the reality of it is there's a lot of work, it's very fast paced, and even when you're not at the office, you kind of have to be thinking about that. So with that said, I'm going to jump into a infographic that we did here for Vices of Ventra. And this was around the time that Ventra launched for the CTA. And when they did that, it happened a little bit prematurely, and it was a rocky start. They had a lot of struggles, and there was just all this information just in newspapers, magazines, about the millions of dollars they wasted and how people were getting 270 Ventra cards in the mail, which is crazy to think about. But it was just in a way that wasn't really digestible. So to kind of break that down, I took this information and kind of laid it out in a little bit of an infographic here, just so you could really take it and read it on the move. You know, you're on the train, you're on a bus. You could look at this in a few minutes and actually understand the scope of what happened and what went wrong. And just showing how that could even be applied to a newspaper in a real world scenario. So it doesn't have to be one of these things where it's you create an infographic, you're not sure where it's going to go from there. You can just keep in the back of your mind, like, hey, this could work in a magazine, you know, this could work in print, because when you do start to like pitch a concept in the real world, that's something you always have to consider. It's like, it may be a great idea, but if you can't apply it to something that is useful to the client, they're not going to buy off. So another thing that helped out greatly, and I use this every day, is just being able to create mock-ups. This is a key skill to have, and I remember being here and people would always say how important that was and how a lot of other schools really don't enforce that, And I was like, okay, yeah, sure. You know, every school probably really pushes to create these mock-ups and do everything with precision. But when we go into meetings, a lot of times there will be situations where people just don't have clean mock-ups. And that really can take away from a high quality piece that you've made, you've put in hours on, just because either it's a bad print, it just wasn't cut very smoothly, and it just wasn't built very sharp. So that helps a ton. I mean, right now, I work on a lot of web, but we'll follow campaigns from web to print to packaging. And basically, if we have a gift that we're giving to customers, we'll have to mock those up to kind of show the client exactly what we're thinking and actually mail those off to them. So if they don't look good when they first see them, people immediately have that first impression, and if it's a bad impression, it's not going to sell for them. So just being able to build this book, it was a huge challenge because I had never done something like this before. I mean, hundreds of pages, learning how to hand bind a book, it sounded completely overwhelming. And when I first started to do it, it really was. But when you break it down into pieces and you just kind of take it step by step, it doesn't take that much thinking all at once. You can kind of just take it piece by piece and lay these things out. Again, you know, another print piece here is one that works with a lot of imagery and kind of breaking that up with typography. And on a daily basis, I'll work with copywriters and I'll do like the look and feel side and they'll work on the copy, and it never works out where it's they give me the copy, they walk away, and then I lay it out. So there's a lot of back and forth going on where you may have a layout, it works great, but then they give you the information and the messaging and it completely messes up what you had imagined. So just being able to be nimble with laying out imagery and making it work with the messaging as you're doing things is a key skill to have, because that can be applied across, as you see here, like a magazine or even across like a self-mailer, those types of deals. Again, as far as execution with things, learning to build prototypes for maybe a packaging that you haven't seen before. So this is based off of your standard rectangular packaging, but just adding those little details where it goes on a diagonal just to hint at an ammo box is something that takes people away from something they expected. They expect to see, you know, a glasses case where you just take the lid off, but it just adds these little bits of information where it makes it exciting for somebody that opens this at first. And at this point, too, is kind of when I realized how valuable, even if you're a graphic designer, an illustrator, it doesn't matter, being able to photograph the work that you make is super important. Because as you see here, the one on the top left and the top right there, those were actually mocked up. And going into this, I hadn't really mocked up things and then photographed them. I had just been producing these mock-ups. So when it came time to actually put these in a portfolio, it was a little bit of a challenge to figure out how to photograph these in a way that actually would be presentable. So this was something that I hadn't done before. I had a chance to do it here, you know, shoot in the studio. And that was great, work with other students. They kind of would teach me the ropes about exactly how to light this and how to really highlight the product attributes. And that shortly afterwards, when I picked up an internship at Tomy, which makes children's toys, so they do a lot of Pokemon, and a ton of toys for children between the ages of like 3 and 12, I'd say. So going into that, I had a lot of work that was print work and like logo design and typography. So going into it, I expected like, oh great, I'm gonna get to do these things, this will be awesome. But the reality of it was is they had a ton of these sets that they had built, but they did not have instruction manuals for. So similar to how if you have like a Lego set, it'll highlight the pieces in steps and kind of break it down so people can build these, so parents can build them, so kids can build them. So I spent that entire summer photographing these sets and actually building them and then taking pieces off and photographing those pieces. So little did I know when I did the ammo box photography, but that ended up at least giving me a little boost once I hit this point where I was in this internship and I actually had a basic understanding of where to go and how to photograph these types of deals. And aside from that, it was just a cool experience being able to sit all day and know that you basically were playing with toys for for your job, and you're getting paid to do it. So that was just pretty sweet to do. And basically this kind of boils down to one thing. It's like, as you keep going, pick up the skills that you don't have. If you don't know how to photograph, if you don't know how to design, maybe you don't know how to illustrate. I know when I started here, I really struggled with life drawing. That was something that I hadn't done before. It was something that I kind of came in blindly to. And although it was really tough in the start, it does help. So what I would say is just pick up those things that you can do. Do what you can. And figure it out along the way. You know, the more you do it, the more you'll figure it out. Nobody expects you the first time to do something to really just completely blow them away and have a project that is perfect. So, and the more you do it, the faster you'll be at it, and the more ideas will come to you quicker. So, one of those examples is when there was an opportunity to basically build a space inside of the Oak Park Library, where people could go and interact, and just a space for students to relax, for parents to relax. You could go in there and read, but something that was interactive. So I had this idea to build a giant light bright, basically. And at the time, I had no clue how I was going to do this. I just was like, this sounds awesome, but let's really try to figure this out. So came to the conclusion of using golf tees and pegboard. And at first, I was like, all right, great. You know, pegboard has perfect amount of holes. The golf tees will really stick in there. It'll be perfectly fine. Well, I had no clue that the holes on the pegboard were actually too far apart. So we had to go through, there's about 10 pieces of pegboard, so it's probably about the length of this wall here, and actually drill holes in between the holes that were already on the pegboard. And so that was something I'd never done, just kind of figured it out along the way. And on top of that, ended up ruining my mom's kitchen table using the drill. So that was kind of interesting conversation. And then it ended up working out. So you just figure it out and you just focus, take it piece by piece, and in the end you'll step back and realize like, hey, this may not have worked out as easily as I originally thought, but in the end it does work out if you just stay focused on what you're doing. And outside the classroom, I would say just to kind of keep your head in like the creative field or what you want to focus on doing, whether it be like web or logo design. Let's say you want to do web. Pick up some side projects, you know, maybe work with some friends who are already working on web or they want to have a website set up, and use that as an opportunity where it's no risk to basically figure it out for yourself what you want to do. So when I was here, there was these presentations just like there is today, and I picked up the opportunity to basically make posters for these. And a lot of times they're a very quick turnaround, and it gave me an opportunity to concept quickly and not have to really have that grade or critique hanging over my head. It was just try these different styles and see what works, see what doesn't work, and it's just an opportunity to try something with no risk. And along that, outside of classroom, I would say work with other people in different fields. So this is a piece that I worked with Jeff Santon, who is an illustrator here. And you have these great illustrations, and I really liked working with types. We came up with a plan to basically take a sandwich shop, a small sandwich shop here in Chicago, that had these massive sandwiches, but their branding was just not really highlighting the quality of their food. And he created this awesome illustration where it's a massive sandwich, and then you have the guy on the top just kind of staking that flag in there, and showing how that could work as a poster with the Conquer Your Hunger behind it to really point towards what exactly this food product does for them. It, no matter what, no matter your appetite, it really will fill you up. And then we took it even a step further and like, hey, you know, how could this create a whole campaign? Like, how could we bring this across, not only a poster, but maybe some in-store branding, like a coaster or t-shirts? So we landed at these two points here. At the same time, I would say if you have friends or family members that, you know, are trying to start a business or they already have and they want to have some branding but they don't really know where to go, just pick it up as an opportunity to try something. It doesn't matter if there's no budget. What no budget means is less pressure. You have less to lose. And this one here was a decal that I created for Hertz DB, which is a custom audio solutions. And they basically build like subwoofer boxes, tweeters for like door panels. And it gave me an opportunity to not only create a logo, but instead of doing, hey, that it's gonna be X amount of dollars, we just decided like, let's exchange our services. So he's gonna build me a subwoofer box, and then I created the decal for him. So there's workarounds that you can still do work and not do it necessarily for free, but do it for a trade. And you know, pick up different logos. This one here is one that I recently did for a friend of a friend who had a boat that he was restoring and wanted to have kind of that back decal on it and wanted to go with Green Bay's because this was a team that he had a lot of heart for, Green Bay, and he was originally from there. So I had no clue how to do a boat logo. I had never done this. I hadn't even thought about like what size it could be printed on, what size the boat was. But I was like, yeah, sure, let's try it. You know, this would be awesome to see on the water. And on top of that, the boat itself was just badass. So I was like, this is pretty sweet. Let's try this out. So kind of went in blindly, took that one on, and eventually his friend saw how well it had turned out and how smoothly it had went, and he was like, hey, I really want one for mine now. So what started as a project once turned into a second one, which then you could charge a little bit more, and you could keep going like that. So if you do it right every time and really just put all your heart into making it turn out the way you expect, it can pay off in unexpected ways through people referring you, to other people noticing it, and just kind of starting a conversation and asking, you know, who made this? This is pretty cool. And then I would say while you're here, take these projects that you start in the classroom, whether it be like packaging, or you're in the web design course, or you're rebranding and doing like the letterheads, the business cards, the envelopes, and just take it one step further and blow it out into an entire campaign. Because that way in your portfolio it will be much more rounded out, and when you have somebody that you're looking to have hire you look at it, they'll quickly realize that, hey, they not only know how to do this in print, but they see how this works as a piece to a bigger picture. So one example of that is with Colorburst here. This started as a classroom project for rebranding a nonprofit organization. And this one was Colorburst, and they did screen printing and helped out by employing children and adults with learning disabilities and kind of gave them some hands-on experience and really helped them get involved in this. So we took what they already had set up. It was a great cause, but their branding just really did not reflect that. So we blew out a new look and feel for the letterhead, the business card, the envelopes, and then shortly after that, in the web design course, we took it a little bit further and blew out a website for them. So this is all in the classroom. This is all just concept. This isn't actually working with the client, but it shows that you can and really do think about how this can work across the board, from brochures to websites to print. And it just, it helps you really stand out from the other people that are looking to get hired for the same position. So this one here was one of the first experiences I had with creating the look and feel for an app. And this was pre-Beer Advocate, which there's a ton of beer apps out there now. But at the time, there was only a few, and they really didn't highlight on what the products were that you were searching for. It was more just telling you what's out there. So this one allowed you to quickly search for a beer product and then basically get facts about it real fast. So I applied this later down the line to help expand a print campaign. Basically, the fundamentals I learned about the app, I was like, hey, you know, we have this urban artist packaging design course going on here. And what if we took this one step further and actually created a website and an app for this? So on top of, you know, starting off with the packaging, we took some of those cool little icons and just details, put that on some example merch, and then brought that across to not only a desktop flow, but even an app for on-the-go customers, and showing how these two would work together. So the website would be a little bit more detailed, would allow you to go through all the information, and then the app, just so it wasn't exactly reflecting what was on the website, would be a simplified version. So really taking out that top header tile there, focusing on the products, and just giving a feel that's very similar to Amazon, where you can, if you're online on the computer, it's a much bigger experience than when you're on your phone. They almost make it like a 1-2-3 click process. So that was kind of the thought here with working with the app. And another app that I started work on here as well was building one that would allow you to search for paint swatches, whether it be, you know, if you see the colors in a painting and you really want to know what paint swatch and what brands sell a paint that's close to that color. So I created an app that was more of a utility and would allow you to, whether you're a painter, you know, you're a homeowner and you're just looking to repaint your house, it would allow a vast demographic to really use this app and be useful on a daily basis. So what started as just a few screens for the Hop Helper app, on this one just took it a little step further and blew out the entire flow. So showing how you could take a photo, select the colors within the photo, and then actually search for those products within the web. And this would ideally be linked to, you know, Home Depot, Ace, and you can actually see what brands sell the color paints that are close to what the one was that you just photographed. And then just to take it a little step beyond that, you know, presenting this when somebody's going through your website, it might help to just kind of wow them a little bit to kind of hook them in before they go through this web flow that you're going to show. So maybe lay out just a really short GIF. I mean, just something that kind of grabs their attention, shows that you've really thought about how this could work when you go to interact with it, and grabbing their attention right off the bat. Because when you see a lot of screens, you see all this information, sometimes it's hard to process, but when you see it in motion, people pick up very quickly when it's a video opposed to reading something. And this project here, actually, when we were finishing up, a graduate of the academy, Horacio, stopped by and was looking for a hand at a company he was working at, just to help out with production and a little bit of web work, kind of gathering images and, you know, changing typography on WordPress sites, and came across this and asked me if I would like to help out in the studio a few days a week after class. So this was towards the end of my senior year. I was still in class, and as I'm sure you guys know, if there are any seniors in the room, that's like crunch time. When you're towards that very end is like the mad dash to the finish to get your portfolio where you want it, to kind of search for the jobs that you're looking for, and it's just an overwhelming amount of work. But just being able to step away from that and still being able to create, I decided to, 3 days a week, pick up a role at Linden Studio as a designer. And it was a part-time role. It was just helping out on an as-needed basis. It was a small team, this space we worked in, that included the director, the senior designer, and a UI UX specialist, and then myself, who at the time was clueless what I was walking into, really didn't know much besides what I had gathered from being here, but it transitioned really nicely. I started to help out with food product packaging, finding photographs for the featured vegetables that were used on these, and building out those mock-ups that we would then photograph and sell to the client. So the products that these stores went in, or the stores that these products went in, were Whole Foods, Mariano's, Jewel-Osco, that type of deal. And it also was one of the first times I had hands-on experience seeing the packaging process from concept to the final product. And it really gave me a better understanding of what was involved in the printing process and how to position the product in the market. So that goes from like hierarchy of the messaging on the actual product to creating that billboard effect where like you walk into a store and you might see Tide and it's like six of those next to each other, it creates this billboard effect. And that was the first time I had heard of that, and I had no idea that what an impact that could make. But now I realize, like, just having things be consistent where it's almost like the packaging sitting side by side continues that pattern has a huge effect on when consumers walk in and they see that. They just immediately think it's a higher-end product because it's well thought out, and it catches their eye more so than having each one act independently. So it started to pick up a little bit. They started to gain my have my trust a little bit more, that I could take things on, that I was picking up on what they were asking me to do. So they gave me an opportunity to take a barbecue sauce that was for a small father-son company. They did this out of their home, and create basically an identity around this barbecue sauce. So because of that fact that it was a very small company, I wanted to bring in the typography that's a little bit roughed up. Seems like it's handmade because these were handmade barbecue sauces, and really just adding in that background texture of that like cardboard, fiberboard feel, kind of giving it, even though it's on the web, giving it that handmade feel. So we carried across the barbecue sauce and brought that through to the second product they had, which was the tartar sauce, and giving these both in the same environment, but each one kind of their separate identity. So really focusing the tartar sauce around those blues, those cool tones, and still keeping it on that butcher's paper. So shortly after that, they allowed me to actually expand what the product look and feel was on print and these small social media bits into an entire website that featured a recipes page, a home page, and a little bit of information about the actual makers of this sauce. So it doesn't seem like a ton, but at the time it really did seem like a huge deal. It was only a 3-page site, but the amount of work that I saw from the outside just seemed overwhelming. And this was kind of the tipping point where I realized, hey, you can just take things piece by piece. Even if you don't think you know what you're doing, chances are you know more than you think. And just take each day at a time and you'll be able to get there. So after working there for about a year, I was really enjoying what I was doing there, and I was starting to pick up a little bit more web work. And at the same time, I was asked by somebody who actually saw my Behance if I wanted to help them with their new business. And it started out as just a logo development and brand manual. And then once we blew that out, it actually turned into, hey, can you build a website for us? And I had done this before working with a team. I had never done this on my own. So I knew it would take me a little bit of time to actually figure this out along the way, but I didn't want to pass it up because this was a learning experience. This was a time to actually figure this out, and I didn't know if somebody else would ask me to build the website after this. So I decided to go freelance at that point, really focus on that, and it was kind of a moment of worry. As I'm sure you guys all feel, you think, did I make the wrong choice? Should I be second-guessing myself? And I quickly realized that it was the right choice. It allowed me to really focus on creating this brand for Delta Derivatives. And it was, you know, a business-to-business style site. It wasn't the most creative side, but you really had to focus on breaking down the information, and there was a lot of moving pieces associated with it. They had an interface for people to log into, they had a sign-up form, and if I had not backed away from working at Linden Studio and I tried to work both sides, I probably would have burned bridges on both ends. I wouldn't have been putting in great work at Linden Studio, and I really would not have been putting in great work for this project I said I could take on. So I took this on, finished the project, and then I was like, all right, now what? Like, now where do I go? Should I have not done this? So I started reaching out to recruiters, reaching out to anybody I could, really just to see if they would throw me a rope, see if I could pick up a role for, you know, contract work, whether it be for 2 weeks, 4 months, a year. And at that point, one of the recruiters I was working with, he said, hey, I think I have something for you that is over at Wilson Sporting Goods. And I was like, okay, that sounds awesome. Definitely will take it. And he's like, but it's packaging for footballs. And I was like, footballs, how do you package a football? Is it like just the box? What are we talking about here? So I said yes, I was jumping at it. It was a very short turnaround on these. I worked there for about 3.5 weeks, was the contract for that, and was basically cranking out these designs that you see where it's like the Falcons, Green Bay versus Chicago Bears, was cranking these out for all the NFL teams. And how this worked was very similar to Nike ID, where you log on, you can pick your style of shoe, and then you can customize it. But it's not a free-for-all when you go in there and customize it. They allow you to choose from like a few different colors, placement of logos, that type of deal. So this worked like that. It was just a ton of pieces and assets to really crank out. So at first when I walked in, it was a little bit of a struggle trying to figure this out. I'd never worked with this team. It was a much larger team, larger than anything else I had worked on before. The meetings were huge. It was 20 people in a room. You would have client meetings every week. And then at the end of the week, you would present to the client over the phone or in video conference. And that was something that I had never done at all. And it was intimidating from the start. But I just went in, kept at it, finished the project. And then shortly after that, I was asked if I want to take on another freelance role at Leo Burnett. So when I ended up at Leo Burnett, the kind of the same work environment on an even larger scale. So the amount of people in there, just how big the place was, I was constantly trying to figure out who I should talk to, what I should do, what exactly my role was coming in. And I would say at your first job, don't get discouraged by that. Everybody goes through that. And just ask a ton of questions. They expect you to ask questions. They want you to ask questions. It shows that you're interested. It shows that you're really focused on being there and you care about it. So once I landed at Leo Burnett, I really wasn't sure what I was going to be working on. They told me that it would be a combination of new business and then you'd be bouncing around between teams because that is commonly how it works when you're freelance. They try to basically plug you in where they need help. So you really have to be nimble with your design style, with talking and working to people, because you're gonna work with a ton of different personalities, a ton of different, I would say, skill sets. People are at all different levels. They have their strong points and their low points. So I started a freelance there about a year ago. I was brought on full time as an art director in December. And to give you a little bit of breakdown of how my workflow is now, I work with a team of copywriters and other art directors, and then in charge of us is a creative director who kind of oversees all the work we produce, signs off on it, and then we will go into meetings internally and then to the client. So it involves developing campaigns and blowing out those campaigns and seeing them all the way through until the finished product. And that's from DMs to print to emails, website campaigns, promotions. We do games for some of them, and even a little bit of video. And I've never worked with video before walking into here, but have quickly realized that just keep picking up when people throw you a rope. Somebody will ask you, hey, do you want to help out on this video? Say, hey, yeah, I'd love to help out. I haven't done this before, but I'd like to learn. Right there, they know that you're really interested in doing this, even if you haven't done it before, and you're ambitious to actually try to succeed at it. So the clients that we work with are Allstate, ones who do the Mayhem ads. And then on the ARC side, we just won Miller Coors. So we do all of their in-store print work, their end caps, that type of deal. And along with United Healthcare. So you might have seen the Chuck Norris commercial recently where he throws like the salt shaker at the old guy throws a salt shaker at Chuck Norris and then he like kicks it back at him. That was a team that worked on that as well, and that's actually one of my coworkers who helped out on that, which was pretty cool. So I got to hear about how it was talking to Chuck Norris on the phone and running ideas past them, and that's just crazy to see how small the world actually is once you get out there and start working on things. And I would just say that overall, the creative community may seem huge at first, but once you get in it, it is really small. It is a tight-knit group of people, and just try not to burn bridges, because regardless of what you think, there may be somebody you walk into a room and the person that you used to work for is good friends with them and they've known each other for a very long time, and it kind of sets the pace for what they expect from you. But if you just really stay honest and just hustle hard at it, it does help. It does help because people will, you know, notice from other agencies, that the large agencies, Leo Burnett, DDB, all of those, everybody that's worked in one most likely has worked in another one, so they do know people that work there. And if you move from one to the other and you already have a bad rap going in, chances are it's really not going to help you. So I just say make some good connections with people that you think are really creative, really inspiring, and just try to stay close to those people because those are the ones that are going to end up teaching you the most in some of the most unexpected ways. So with that said, I just want to give you a quick breakdown. I know I was kind of curious when I was in school exactly like what does somebody's week look like that is doing this already. And basically on Mondays, the whole team will regroup. That includes like the account side, the developers, the production team, and then the creative team. And we'll regroup, talk about the feedback from the client and the plan moving forward for the week. And then later on towards the end of the week, we have internal critique, which we basically sit down at a long table. It's all the creatives on one side, all the account team on the other side, and we present our work similar to how you're presenting today or how you do it in the classroom. Explain, you know, why you made certain decisions creatively, whether it be from the look and feel to the messaging, and why you think that works with this campaign. And then they'll give us feedback. We have a day or two to kind of turn it around, make some adjustments, and then we'll present it to the client. And it's the same tempo there where it's all of us in one room presenting. They tell us their initial thoughts, and then they send the feedback over, and it just kind of keeps going in that pace right there. So I really hope that this was helpful. I know I had a ton of questions when I was here. I still have a ton of questions, still kind of figuring it out. It's been an extremely short period of time. It seems like it's only been about a year since I was here, just because once you get moving on it, you just kind of lose track of time. You're just like focused on what's the next step, what do I want to do next. So I'm just really hoping that you guys learned something from this today, and I'm sure I'm going to learn something from you as well. So thank you, and I'd love to hear your thoughts. If you guys have any questions, any comments, just throw them my way. Yeah. There's never a stupid question at all. Yes.
First of all, congratulations, Danny, on your success.
Thank you.
And more of a comment, really. Almost everything you said, I try to teach. And I think that hearing it from you, I'm sure there are people in this room right now who have been in my classroom. I'm not sure they fully believe me, you know. But hearing it from you was fantastic, because just talking about things like mock-ups, talking about just getting out there and being excited by a new project, even though you haven't actually got any experience or wanting to do it, that enthusiasm that you have comes across. And you had that enthusiasm when I first met you, actually, and it was what I rather liked was how you introduced this by talking about printer not working.
Yeah.
That was the very first conversation you and I ever had. And you taught me how to use that printer.
Oh yeah, I've been through printers. They don't cooperate with me. We don't get along. So
I do have a question for you, though. You talked about being freelance for it. Could you talk a little bit about how you did your pricing with your clients?
Yeah, so the pricing really started off basically asking, before you throw out a number to the client, I would just ask them, what's their budget? Just be flat out, you know, what do you have to work with here? Because it kind of gives you an expectation of how much effort they're willing to put into this and how much time they're willing to put into their own project to make sure that A, you don't underdeliver, and B, that you don't overdeliver. If it's something that they kind of see as a side project on their end, and it's they're not really going to focus on it, chances are they're going to be a little bit slower on feedback. They're really not going to give you detailed information from the start, and you know, just have to kind of price accordingly to that. So if it's something that you think that is going to turn into a bigger project, I would say, hey, you know, I'm going to price it one way at the beginning, kind of break it down into pieces. So with the delta derivatives one, I didn't go into there and say, hey, here's what I want to bill you for across the board. I said, let's take on the lockup first. Let's see how this goes. And then if everything goes smoothly, if you're happy, if I'm happy, then we'll take the next steps and really work on the website. And so, you know, the logo took a lot of time creating that brand manual, but then once I developed that trust, they were more accepting to a higher rate once I hit the web. So I would say when you're going into a project, just keep it simple, is just ask them flat out, what budget do you have to work with? You know, is this something that you're envisioning turning into a larger campaign, or is this a one-time deal that you're looking to bring to like a trade show or some sort of event? And then kind of go from there and price from there. So basically, don't show all your cards first. Let the client show more cards than you're showing, and then let that kind of guide you into pricing something where you're not lowballing yourself and, you know, not so out there that they won't call you back. So yeah.
Do you ever take a position like of course when you're freelancing, you're freelancing, you're taking like more than one project at a time? Like how do you go about like maintaining like doing both at the same time, like being overly frustrated doing more than one project?
Yeah, sure, that's a great question actually. When I went into the Delta Derivatives website, that was a huge undertaking, and to kind of force myself to deliver when I said I would. At the beginning, when we were filling out like the contracts of how things would be broken down with payment, I also included a timeline in there of when I would deliver things to them and when I was expecting feedback. And that basically set boundaries to where I had to hit that deadline and they had to hit their end of the deal, because if they didn't hit their end of the deal, then I could say, hey, you know, I was expecting this Friday, you gave me it Monday, so now on my end, I'm gonna need 2 more days to do this. So I think by setting deadlines and sharing that with the client as well on all of your projects that you do freelance really helps kind of set up a schedule for yourself, because you can block out time, like, hey, this thing's coming up, it's going in first, this is kind of hot, I really need to work on this. But I told the other person that I'd have this in 2 weeks out from now, so I still have 2 weeks to work on it. So I think it's just sharing that timeline with your client and also making sure that you follow your own timeline. It just basically creates almost like when you're here and, you know, an instructor will say, hey, you have a deadline of this day, you're playing that role almost. You're creating a deadline for yourself. Yeah.
Can you talk about the pros and cons of freelancing versus the pros and cons of having a structured job?
Yeah, definitely. So with freelancing, I'd say the major kind of first is learning how to critique your own work and being able to find people outside of the client that you can kind of run things by ahead of time, get somebody else's eyes on it. And along with that is just scheduling yourself. With deadlines and setting that up, along with the business side of it, it does suck out a lot more time, whereas if you're working for a company, they kind of handle all of that. You don't have to deal with like the payment side, how you're going to actually be paid for the work, But the plus side of it is that you're not stuck in meetings for a huge portion of the week, and you kind of set your own schedule, so you don't have unexpected things come up in between. You're able to more be able to regulate when you're going to do the work, how you're going to do it. You know, let's say you've had a really long week and you want to call it a day at 3 o'clock. You can have that opportunity to do it. But on the flip side, I would say the cons sometimes of working in a larger company in a short period I have is really being in those meetings. You go in and you just have to understand that these are meetings you have to go to. There are a lot of times we have to meet up with people, and it does eat away in a large portion of the regular workday. So that sometimes does lead to working late nights or coming in early. But on the plus side, working with a huge team of people, there's always somebody to go to with a question. Whether it be from like, hey, I really want to have this printed piece debossed, and I want to add like this crazy varnish on it. You don't have to do any of that footwork yourself. You have somebody to turn to that's what they do for a living. They enjoy doing that, and they're more than likely to help you find that and actually make it happen. So you waste a lot less time hunting down how to do the mechanical side of things, and you get to focus more on the work and just getting feedback on the work. So those are the two barriers, I guess, to both that I've kind of found in the short time I've done it. So.
So at Leo Burnett, say now, how many hours do you usually work, like, in a day?
In a day, it kind of ranges. I would say my standard schedule lately has been a lot more than usual. I have been there pretty late over this past month, I would say, just because right now we have a wave of work coming in, and you just kind of have to strike when the iron's hot. But on a regular week, I would say, like, 45, 50 hours is kind of like that middle ground in there. So yeah, it is a little bit longer than the standard day of maybe some of your friends doing other roles, but it kind of comes in waves. You know, sometimes we'll have a little bit of downtime where we're waiting for feedback. We're in the middle of the day, we're able to go out as a team, kind of go to lunch and, you know, think about ideas that we have going, but then other days it's go time. You're there, you know, you start at 7 a.m, you go home at midnight. So it really does kind of fluctuate and come in waves. Yeah.
Hey, Danny. Welcome back.
Thank you.
You had mentioned when you were freelancing that you had worked with some agencies to help you find work.
Yeah.
I know there's several in the city that we work with. Curious who you were working with. And I'm wondering also, was it an agency that helped you get your foot in the door at Leo Burnett?
Yes. I worked with, at the time, was with a guy named Frank over at Creative Circle. And I reached out to him originally just seeing like, hey, I'm looking for, you know, any sort of web work or print work. I was kind of in the middle ground there, wasn't sure really which one I wanted to follow. And he ended up getting me in touch with Wilson. And then after that contract came to a close, he was the one who initially was saying, hey, we have this 4-month contract for Leo Burnett. And that 4-month contract turned into 6-month contract. And then it just kept getting pushed back further, until it hit a point where it was like, yes, we think we found a spot where you kind of fit in to how this works here. But in that period of time freelancing there, I was bouncing around between teams quite a bit, which was intimidating at first because you're picking up like different styles, working with a ton of different people. But it did help in the end because now I have a little bit better idea of what each brand does and how it fits in.
What would you say are some of your most important people skills, seeing as how you're diversifying so much of what you're doing and taking on new things?
I would say as far as people skills is, number one, just not being a jerk when you're talking to somebody. It really does sound kind of simple and obvious, but there's been times where you approach somebody and you ask them a question and they're kind of off-putting, or they give you a hard time, and then lo and behold, 4 months later, they have a question for you, and do you do the same thing to them or do you not? At that point, like realizing, hey, just treat everybody on the same level. Don't let your experience that you have or somebody else's experience kind of make a difference. And just being able to work with people no matter their skill set, no matter their level, other people around you will pick up on that and they'll be more willing to ask you to help out. You may not be their number one choice from your skill set level, but if you're somebody that's easy to work with and you do make adjustments and make yourself available and really take feedback seriously and listen, that's somebody that they most likely will want to work with over somebody that has better skills than you do. Just because it makes it easier to communicate and it makes it easier to be around. If you're around somebody that frustrates you all day, you're going to end up creating not so great work, and at the end of the day, you're going to go home and not be happy. So, yeah, just being humble about what you've done and being open to take criticism and feedback, I think, is number one with working with people. So, yeah.
When you were freelancing, did you, when you got a job, did you operate on a handshake, or did you actually have a contract, a piece of paper that you would have your clients sign?
So when I was picking up, I did a few small jobs while I was here, and one of them, I did a website, and of course, everybody's probably been here once or twice. I ended up getting burned on it, and you know, you have that happen once, let that be a lesson. Don't let it happen again, because then it's shame on you type of deal. So after that happened once, yes, everything I did had a contract, and it's super easy to send over. It doesn't have to be an in-person contract. Now you can do through Acrobat, you can actually do like digital signatures, send those fields over, kind of the same way if you're doing like tax forms. So there's really no reason not to have a contract to some degree, so definitely.
You call it a purchase order, PO? Is that still something that's relevant? Getting a purchase order from a client?
I haven't.
Okay.
Thank you. So far, at least. So. But yeah.
I really like this presentation. I think you really said some important things, and what you said about problem solving and, you know, not thinking about the big problem, but the steps of the problem. I wanted to ask, do you see a lot of design conferences or lectures by other designers?
I haven't seen outside of, like, we'll have people come in and present at Leo, like Spotify, Snapchat, Instagram, but before that, the one that helped out a ton was, I'm drawing a blank on the name right now, but it was at UIC, and it was through AIGA. And I want to say it was like $40 to do, but it was a portfolio review that I attended almost immediately before we give our like exit presentation. And I went in kind of expecting it just to be some small companies, a little bit of feedback. But in actuality, it was some of the higher up people that you would end up interviewing with at VSA, Ogilvy, We Are Mammoth, these huge, huge companies. And it's kind of a no pressure situation because they let you give your spiel, basically what you do in an interview. And then at the end, they kind of break down what your strong points are, what your weak points are, what they're looking for if you actually were to apply there. And that was great. I mean, after that, I actually stayed in contact with one of the gentlemen from Ogilvy for a few months, and I asked him at first, like, hey, do you have anything available? And he's like, I really like your work, I like what you're doing, but I don't have a spot for you right now. If you ever have questions though, just bounce them off me. So when I was looking for freelance work and trying to pick that up, I would send him messages occasionally and saying like, hey, how should I go about this? And he ended up being a little bit of a mentor for a short period of time, which helped out a ton. So I would say, yeah, attend those talks, because chances are they're there, they're really excited to present to you, They really want to help people. So you might have an opportunity to actually sit down with them and talk one-on-one, and that can lead to things down the line, and kind of having somebody as a mentor or even later on leads to like a job opportunity. Cool.
Thanks, Nick.
Thank you, guys.